So I want to give a moment for these wonderful law enforcement officers. First, let's appreciate them one more time. Sunday morning, giving up of their time. And I just want to appreciate you guys. I want to thank you for being here. Want to give a moment for you to introduce yourselves, who you're representing, and then we're going to get right into it. We're going to enjoy ourselves. All right, and let's set the ground rules. You know, we're going to have some dialogue. We're going to raise some questions. We're going to hear. We're going to give you an opportunity to ask a few questions. But what we're not going to do is in any way, shape, or form, we're going to belittle, badger, or disrespect these men and women that work and serve so hard to make sure that we live safely. So I don't know about you, but I appreciate each and every one of y'all. And if anything kick off in my house, I guarantee you I'm calling 911 and some bros to show up. So, all right. Ladies first down there on the end.
Good morning. My name is Carol Adams. I'm a sergeant with the Richmond City Police Department.
Good morning. My name is Raymond Fitz. I'm also a sergeant with the Richmond Police Department.
Good morning. My name is Will Rollins. I'm with the Enrico Police Department. I'm on the motor unit.
Good morning. My name is Demetrium Melton. Everybody call me Didi. I'm with the Richmond Police Department as a detective.
Good morning. My name is James Deloach. I am with the Richmond office of the FBI as a special agent and civil rights coordinator.
Wow. You need two mics.
You talk about a mic drop. good morning, folks. First, I want to give glory to God, and I want to express our appreciation for you all having us here. Are we on Facebook Live as well?
What are we on? Periscope, Facebook?
To our fans and family out on Periscope, I want to say welcome this morning as well. My name is Tony Pham, and I serve as in-house counsel for the Honorable C.T. Woody Jr., the sheriff of the city of Richmond. And so I work at the local city jail.
All right. So just in case you didn't catch it, Richmond Police Department, Henrico, Richmond, the FBI in the house, and... So look, if you was here and you had some bad intentions, this is not the morning. Because some criminals be on the short bus. So let me help you out. If you had some criminal intents, this is not the morning. Okay. All right. So again, can somebody, y'all need some water or something? Everybody all right? Got coffee? Everybody good? Okay, good. All right. So you guys are not immune to what you're seeing. Everybody sees it around the world as fellow law enforcement and as humans. Give us some opinions from, I guess, your perspective as law enforcement officers on the videos, on the events that are taking place. Give us a little bit of your opinions and your thoughts. Yeah.
I got it. They chicken. All right. Well, first of all, it's very, very alarming and disheartening because every time somebody loses their life, no matter who's on the other end pulling the trigger, that's a loss to us as people and as human beings. And I think, and that's why we're here today, is that we need to have more conversations, but it's incumbent upon the older generations and us to educate about our young people about law enforcement. We all wake up every morning. We're all human beings, just like the people that we respond to and we interact with out in the street. But we must teach people to understand what the law represents and what we represent. And when we respond or we interact with someone, we have a job to do. And we all took an oath to put our lives before yours. Our lives will go while we are protecting you. Our families live with that every day. When we wake up and we go out to work every day, our children, our significant others know that there's a possibility we may not come home because of an encounter to protect and to serve and to save somebody else's life. And so it's incumbent that we encourage you all to do things like this and to come to the police departments. And Pastor White and I do a lot of things together,
yep.
But we have to teach the young people how to be respectful, what authority means. Because when we have these encounters, things are lost. And we can't Monday morning quarterback what's happening with an officer in response to a shooting or something like that because we were not there. Unless you were there from beginning to end, we just do not know. I encourage you and please read everything. When the details come out, find all those intimate details as to what was happening along the way. So it's incumbent that the law, that justice is given when there is a wrong, and that people are prosecuted no matter what their profession is when they take a life. And if they did not follow the protocol, we all are bound by our police department's protocol and the law. And what most people don't know is that we could be involved in a shooting and not be charged criminally, but we still have to go endure a second investigation where we could lose our job just for not following department policy. So the more conversations you have, the more you get to know about policing and what we do, then that would help. But we have something at the Richmond Police Department called Milo. And Milo is an interactive, I'll say video game, but you all can come as a citizen and you can interact and you can be the police officer. You can respond to a call. You're responding with the screen. You're giving the screen instructions and directions just as if you were a police officer, and you have a matter of seconds to decide what are you gonna do. You have a gun, somebody's not showing you their hands. And we've done this with about 3,000 people in this 2016 so that they could have an understanding as to how quick things happen. And once they happen, you can't undo it. But this is an interactive game, but this gives the community more of a gauge as to what happens on these scenes and when people are out there. And it's tough to make a life or death situation decision, and you only have a matter of seconds when somebody else's life might be at stake.
Come on, I mean, it's open. We just want y'all to tell me. Go ahead.
All right. I will piggyback from one of my sergeants. Like I said, sergeants, and I'm a detective. I'm under them. As an officer, and before I became a detective, I was always on the street for a long time, going on 14 years next year. Becoming a detective, still out there on the street. So I see a lot. Just like we all have seen a lot. I cannot speak on the situation that has happened in other states. I'm not that person or persons that been involved in these situations. But, since you want me to do?
No, shoot, they talking to me. They giving me instructions.
Okay. I got you. But, you know, just, reiterate what my sergeant was saying, is scenarios we have that we go through training on a manual basis at the police department that refreshes you on how you need to react in certain situations. And those scenarios are also open up to you, the citizens, to come and see how you're supposed to act or try to act in a situation when your seconds are very short to make a decision whether I'm going home, you're going home, or in reality, somebody might not go home. I have two kids myself, and you know, I hear a lot from my friends out here that are not involved in the law enforcement world who says, you know, I'm afraid to have my son or daughter go out on the street, try to do whatever, because they might encounter a police officer. I'm telling you personally, I tell my kids this, and I tell anybody else I know, just because of one situation that happened somewhere else, do not let that happen. Make you make the decision to say, you know, I'm afraid of my kids to go out here on their own. No, 99% of the police officers are not here to harm you. Actually, none of us are here to harm you. We took this oath, like she said earlier, we took an oath to protect you. We took an oath to come into a situation where we have no idea what we're going into. To protect you, to protect ourselves, and to protect others that are around. So we have no idea what we're going into when we go into a situation. A lot of these officers that have been involved in these situations had no idea that day when they left out of their home that they would be involved in that situation. So, for me, I cannot speak on them or why it happened, but I can speak for myself and say, and let you know, coming from me as a human being and coming from me as a law enforcement officer, to not think that we're here to hurt you. More like we're here to help you. Try to protect you the best way we can.
Pastor, may I jump in for a minute?
Sure.
Forgive me if I stand up. That's what lawyers do. We walk around a little bit. I wanted to provide some folks a little bit of background. When I was a prosecutor for about 8 years in the city of Richmond, I had the dubious distinction of actually having to prosecute a former deputy sheriff for brandishing a weapon. And then when I went and transitioned to work in the city attorney's office, I had the duty to also defend police officers from the Richmond Police Department for those scenarios where they were sued for the shooting situations. And now, as most people know, I work in-house in a correctional setting. But one of the prevailing sentiments that I recognize in having done the cases as prosecution, but also the cases on the defense side, is that a lot of people in the community and in the departments form a snap decision. They formulate a judgment about a particular situation before all of the facts actually come out. From the experiences that I had, you receive pressure from the law enforcement side when I was doing the case that this was a particular visual of a particular person without understanding the other side, which was the victim who had the shotgun pointed at him. And I, in that role, had to walk that fine line in understanding both sides. In defending the cases, I saw myself on the opposite side trying to explain to folks in the community when there was a police shooting, and this was several years ago before things became so magnified right now through our media, in explaining that before we come to this decision, that's why we have these investigations. We both have the administrative investigation, we have both the criminal and the administrative, and then the facts will come out. But one of the lessons that I try to impart to a lot of the community members is that there are narratives that are always being driven. For whatever reason, whoever's behind the narratives, there's motives behind presenting a particular side through the media and how they portray certain officers. And this is why it's important for the community members through Kick, Snapchat, or Facebook Live, who's listening from afar, to have an opportunity to reach out and discuss these matters with the men and women who work in law enforcement, with the men and women who actually engage and go through these scenarios. I went through them myself specifically. I took you all up on your challenge, and I went through my department's, we call it the firearms training simulator. And it was one of the most eye-opening experiences as a lawyer I could have. It's really sanitized when I get to it, when I'm presenting it in trial. But the experiences, the emotional experiences, the endorphins that go through your system when you're in the zone, as they say, faced with a decision. Nobody, from my experience and the people that I've walked with, the people I work with, the people I talk with, the friends that I have, my experiences are none of them look forward to actually having to draw their weapon on anyone. None of them. Zero. 0% of the individuals that I know of that I've worked side by side with enjoy or experience or go to work wanting to exert some level of force on anyone. But I ask folks in the community when I speak to folks, think of any profession that you know of absent the military that is asked and called upon to enforce the laws of our community. Lawyers don't do it. Quite frankly, we don't. We're at behind the scenes. When these guys are done, we're the ones that see it after the fact. Doctors don't do it. Engineers don't do it. Social workers don't do it. These are the folks that are called to a degree to be the ones that enforce the laws and protect us and stand that line between those that want to do us harm and to be able to enforce those laws. So when we ask folks to place themselves in those tenuous and various situations, it's important to understand the thought processes that go through their mind, because every situation and every case, from my experience and having done these cases, are very different. They are very different. So what I ask members of the community, and I won't take you up because lawyers have a tendency to draw on and on and on, is I ask folks to be patient. I ask folks to take a moment to pause. You can read the articles, you can hear the conversations on Facebook because it normally typically explodes on Facebook, but to take a pause for a minute, because what I've learned in the court of law is there's always three sides to every story. There's one that's someone saying, there's the other one, and then there's what's about to be shown in the courtroom. what comes out. So that's just my take on what I wanted to provide the audience.
I want to do this, not to exclude anyone else from responding, but this is, and it was, I'm so glad he came. Officer Rollins, as you can see, is my wife. We've been friends for how long? Yeah, that long.
Yeah, since 99.
99?
99.
Yeah. Matter of fact, I was pleased to be one of the persons that you chose to refer you. And Ranko called me and asked me so many questions, they scared me. It's like, I ain't did nothing. Why? But I want to get some perspective from you, being, you know, a lot of these interactions, except for the one that I know in Charlotte was, I think that was a black officer involved. There have been white officers with black citizens. So that has to put you in kind of a, you know, so give us some from your perspective, you know, a little bit different.
Okay. Let me start off by saying this. I'm going to stand also. I'm not a polished speaker or anything like that. I actually do very bad at public speaking. But Julius called up on me, asked me to do this for him today. There's no way I was going to turn him down. I've been in the department for a little bit over 15 years now. I've served in quite a few different functions along those times, not only in patrol, but also as community officer. I was with the gang unit for a little while, and here recently, the last 4 years, I've been on the motor vehicle. When I came out of the academy, it was right after 9/11. From the time point when I came out of the academy to current day situations, I can tell you there is definitely an alertness, if you will, a difference in people's perception of law enforcement. That's a very small amount of people that have changed their perception based on what's happened in the country. At least in my point of view. You know, when I started here, I was always told the golden rule, treat people the way you want to be treated. And that's what I do. If I happen to stop you for speeding or something, I walk up, I'm as kind, as genuine as I can be with you. Because I want, if the situation is reversed, my wife, my mom, my sister, my cousin would stop, I would want them to be treated that same way. Okay? After every publicized police-involved shooting, I can tell you there's definitely that apprehension when people walk into places and they see me standing there. A lot of times I'll go up to Wawa, grab me a cup of coffee in the mornings. 99% of the folks walk in, they say good morning to me. Some people kind of look at me and they go on about their way, go get a coffee. Sometimes I'll walk over and I'll say good morning. Just to try to interact with them, let them know, hey, I'm human. You know, this is a uniform, it's a profession. Is this part of me? Yeah, I've been doing it 15 years. You're right. This is part of me. But this ain't who I am. I'm still a person. I'm flesh. I'm blood. I'm just like each and every one of y'all that are sitting here. I got feelings. I got emotions. Y'all can hear the quivering of my voice right now because I'm standing up here talking, right? All right. Like I said, I'm not prim. I'm not polished. I'm horrible at this. I'm a practicing Christian, though.
Amen. All right.
But I don't want anybody to be scared of me just because I'm a cop. You know, cop's not a bad word. You can call me a cop. It's okay. All right, you can call me an officer. You can call me whatever you want to call me. But there's no reason to be afraid of me. I'm not here to hurt you. You know, I don't wake up in the morning going, oh, I get to put my gun on, go to work, and get into something. Nah. You know what I do in the mornings? I get dressed, I get up, put my belt on, walk in. I love you, honey. I love you, kids. I'll see y'all this evening. That's my goal. I got two kids. This young man right here married me over 16 years ago.
Yep.
He officiated my wedding. And so I got my best friend, my wife. And I want to see her each and every day, both before I leave, when I come home. I want her to be able to see me. I want my babies to be able to see me. That's important things in my life. My community is important in my life. I moved to Henrico when I was 8 years old. I'm originally from Southwest Virginia, a little place, Big Stone Gap. Yeah, a little hole in the wall. But I still got a lot of family back down in that area. And anyway, moved up here when I was 8. Lived in Henrico until I was 16. We moved to Amelia. And after that, let's just say that everybody's had challenges in their lives, right? Told you I was going to testify to you today, preacher. I won't testify to y'all today. It's going to be tough. 17 years old, my mom passed away. She passed away in March. Shortly after that, within 3 months, my father remarried. The lady that he married, unbeknownst to me, did not care for certain people. Okay? I was over at the house one day, had a young man with me, his name was Abdul. He happened to be black. She comes in the house, wants to know why he's in the house. Said he's a friend of mine, you need to check my dad. Wasn't raised that way, if that makes any sense. Okay? Well, she proceeded to get upset, went into the kitchen. Granted, I only knew this lady for maybe 2 months. She went into the kitchen, grabbed a hold of an object. I looked at my buddy and told him, get in my car, we're getting out of here. And she chased me through the house. I jumped in the car, I took off, kicked the mirror off the side of the car. Get down the driveway. Dad was pulling in. He's a police officer also. I'm a third generation cop. I told my dad what had happened. He looked at me, shook his head. He goes, well, I can't have you live here anymore. I said, okay. So I need to get my stuff. That was the first time in my life I ever experienced racism. Okay. To that day, I'd never seen it before, never heard of it, yes, but never seen it, never witnessed it firsthand. That somebody could hate somebody solely because of the color of their skin. How did that affect me? Well, I'll tell you, I'm still friends with him to this day, and with all my other friends that I've acquired over the years. From that point, I had to grow up. I went in the military, got my life squared away, United States Navy. But that was my life. You know what I'm saying? That helped me reach the point that I'm at. So I've had experiences in my life, just like each and every one of y'all have, that you've had to overcome, right? Okay. So what everybody up here on this panel is saying today is overcome, be better than what somebody is trying to get you to be, if that makes any sense. A lot of times you have friends, family members, what have you, that will try to pull you down. Don't let them pull you down. You're better than that. I was better than whatever was going on in my young life at that time, and I pulled myself out of it. So just be better than that. As far as current day situations, I can't agree with these guys behind me more. Don't jump to conclusions. How many of us watch football in here? How many of us look at that quarterback and say, why'd you throw that pass? All right, that's Monday quarterbacking right there at its best. All right. Wait till all the facts are out. One thing about this county that I work for, we're transparent with our community. If y'all have questions about anything, we will answer those questions. If y'all have a question about anything I've done in my career, you can come to me and ask me. I won't tell you exactly why I did what I did. Okay? But please, don't be scared of us. We're people too. Again, y'all hear that quivering in my voice? Y'all see this flesh, right? And we're all God's children, right?
Okay.
All right. So let's remember that.
Wow. Okay.
All right. Question is coming. Before I get to questions, I want to ask Special Agent DeLoach, did I say it right? To speak with us just a little bit on, I guess, give us some history of interactions, civil history of these interactions. This is really, in a sense, kind of not anything new. The perception has been out there, the thoughts have been out there. And then from the FBI, because you guys are a little bit removed, your thoughts, your processes, when you see it, when you hear it, on how you guys would look to respond.
Absolutely. First of all, thank you for having us. And I look over at your banners and it says, putting the church back in the community. And that is exactly what we should be doing. I've got about 27 years, I guess it's closer to 28 years in law enforcement now. I didn't grow up being an FBI agent. That's something I have stumbled into along my career. I actually was on the road as a Virginia trooper for a number of years, actually, and a motorcycle officer as well. I have worked those front lines. I can tell you that in the past 27, 28 years of working law enforcement, I've never seen it like this before. One of the things that I think is going to pull us through the times that we are is education. It is you coming out and speaking to these young, brave men and women that are working the front lines. Because as you indicated, perception is some folks' reality. And the reality is what you see and what is put out in the media is not necessarily always the truth. Now, I look at it from a little bit more global view, being in the Bureau. For instance, you look at the shooting that took place in Ferguson with Michael Brown. Everyone was looking at the news and you were following it very closely, but how many of us went back and read the report of that investigation? How many of you got the facts after the fact? Because that's just as important. So the media comes down and in most cases sensationalizes these events. They promote these events as being shootings that happen because of race. And the reality of it is there are more white Americans that get shot by police officers than African Americans. Most don't understand or don't know that. They're not asking the right questions. The Bureau comes in, we look at some of these matters, we look at these matters for whether or not a particular department or an officer has violated a particular individual's civil rights. And I can tell you, when we come in to investigate these types of matters, the race component is really non-existent because it doesn't matter. We will come into Charlotte with the African-American officer who shot the African-American victim, a motorist. We look at that the exact same way we do if a white police officer shoots an African-American person. Very, very similar. There's nothing, as it pertains to the statute, it's the same. And the statute actually doesn't have any race component in it whatsoever. So oftentimes, when we have these situations, the media comes in. The media is where we get most of our information. They have you believe that the FBI or the Justice Department has come in to investigate this because of race. And that's as far away from the truth as it could possibly be. But in a case, we come in, we investigate it. I use Ferguson as a good example. Or you can use Freddie Gray in Baltimore. There are, after the investigation, and we look at these cases based on the statute that's presented to us, or that we have in the United States Code, we determine whether or not, along with the Justice Department, whether or not it's a civil rights violation. Doesn't mean because it isn't a civil rights violation that an individual can or can't be charged by the state. That still can happen. But in a case of, for example, Michael Brown, where it was determined it wasn't a civil rights violation. Again, how many of us went back to read that report? How many reporters went back to Ferguson post that report to report on the findings of that particular report? Not many. You didn't see it on CNN. You didn't see it on MSNBC. You didn't see it on Fox News. They kind of just dropped it and they moved to the next incident. And I will tell you, got an invitation a couple weeks ago to go to the White House to talk about the findings of the President's Task Force on 21st Century Policing. One of the pillars, they identified six pillars. The task force identified six pillars that were essential in moving us forward. And one of those pillars is educating our folks. And I can't tell you, being here, and you know, I assume at some point we'll be taking your questions, that is the most important part of this process, is educating you. I know, you know, I've been in many, many different arenas. As a matter of fact, I was in Atlanta about a week ago and had this conversation, and this is after the Tulsa shooting and the Charlotte shooting that took place. One of the individuals came to me and said, I just don't understand. So you have a shooting that occurs between a police officer and a citizen, and the police officer gets time off with pay, almost as if you're rewarding him or her. And I will tell you, in 27, I know why a police officer is administratively suspended with pay. I understand it. I've been doing this long enough. Every single person on this stage understands that. But the problem is, it's never been conveyed to the general public. People don't understand that when you go through a shooting, you're traumatically invested in that, and you are exposed to a lot. It is a serious, serious incident. It allows, when that officer is suspended, it allows that officer to also receive services. Because you may think, oh, it's part of our job, and we are trained to use our firearms in certain situations. But the reality of it is if it ever happens, that officer is forever, and I do mean forever, changed. Now, I see that we had some military folks in the audience. Ooh, okay, all right. I did my time, left as old Sergeant Major. Ooh, all right. And I can tell you that when you put a young 21-year-old, 24-year-old in Afghanistan or Iraq, and they see some of the things that they see, amen, they discharge their firearms to protect the freedoms in which we enjoy. Folks, they are forever changed. They don't come back to the States as the same individual. It is the exact same thing that happens with police officers who are involved in these in-the-line shootings. It's the exact same thing. So for me, I understand, but for the general public, I want you to understand that an individual that is suspended after a shooting, it's a necessary process. It is an extremely necessary process, but not only for the purpose of the investigation, but also taking care of that person. I'm gonna shut up because I am much more interested in hearing your questions and what your questions are, and I think the entire panel is. So yeah. I'll go ahead and sit back down, but I am so glad to see you guys out here today, because this is how we connect, one, with the community, and two, this is how we educate and push the word out. So thank you.
Thank you. All right, let's get into this part. I think this is the meat of why we came together, is to hear the hearts of the community presented to you guys, and then just to allow you to respond. So for the sake of time, let's try to get a couple of responses on all the questions so we could get all the questions. And not to censor you, but just remember, I think I got about 11 or 12 questions in my hands. So, you know, I know I'm a preacher too. So don't hit me with your NRA, you know, because. All right, y'all ready? Everybody relax? Okay. Here's one. Why does it seem that officers are less equipped to deal with crisis situation with the mental health population?
Well, a lot of departments throughout the country are now training their officers in CIT, crime intervention. I'm sorry.
Crisis.
Crisis intervention training. And that's something that we've really been focusing on. Henrico, Richmond, actually everybody here in this metropolitan area, they go through a 2-week minimum school for crisis intervention training. So that is one of the things. I agree, at one point we were not trained properly. Now we're overcoming that, and we're working on other methods to keep our training current.
Anybody? It's, so there is now a mandatory, and I'm sorry, how long did you say it was?
It's a minimum of 2 weeks school.
2 weeks school.
Yes, sir.
And that's in pretty much the now, being around the mental health profession, unfortunately, that's what my wife and I do. Understanding the different diagnoses, how they play out, you know, the behaviors that are associated with it. I'm not challenging what you're doing. This is strictly information. 2 weeks intense training doesn't seem like it's enough to properly equip you for some of those interactions and to recognize those interactions. And I'm not minimizing what you're doing. I'm just asking, is that the beginning or, you know, of what you're going to do? So, Carol, you itching. Go ahead.
Yes, because we go through the training, but for us, it's to contain the situation until we get RBHA and the other service providers there with us. So we're responding to a call, so we have to go to meet this person or this situation, and we have to be able to contain it until we can get the service provider that is the professional in that particular area, and then we will move to the next step.
With CIT, there has become a big collaboration to work with mental health companies outside of yourselves to come into those crisis situations and provide, I guess, an intense level of response to those with you guys. So you're not doing it on your own. There is now a big collaboration with the community board services and sources.
Right. Everything in policing that we do is a collaboration. We're just one part of the city. We're supposed to make everybody safe, but we're social services, RBHA, Child Savers, any service provider that can assist us with helping a situation outside of taking someone to jail. Taking them to jail, we can put them in the car and take them away, but the other services, we need those partners to come in to assist us so that we can handle each incident delicately and in the right manner.
And I guess I was pushing because I wanted to get that part out there. It was, because we put so much on you guys. We expect you to be police, babysitters, you know, mental health professionals and
counselors.
I wanted to, again, good morning, Sergeant Raymond Fitch, Richmond Police Department, give you a little background. I've been with the department roughly a little over 23 years. In that time frame, I've had the opportunity to work in internal affairs, that organization that investigates officers who are supposedly or allegedly doing things they shouldn't be doing. That's on the criminal and administrative side that I spoke about earlier. One of the biggest things that I know the Richmond Police Department is doing, as well as Henrico, the arm of, as we said earlier, educating the public of what's going on with the police department. On our side, we're doing a lot of training. And the question about dealing with mental health situations, that's just another arm of our training. We have a lot of training dealing with use of force. With the mental health arm of is, again, training. A lot of what we do falls back on training, and knock on wood, that has helped us keep our community safe.
Okay, go ahead.
Thank you.
So I absolutely think that's a great question. And I can tell you, for an agency like the FBI, who's governed by the federal government, it's easy to do that. For the United States military, it's easy to do that. But when you have different departments who fall under different guidelines, different guidances, different statutes for different states, that's a little bit more difficult. So you take a department like Richmond PD or Henrico. By the way, you're very fortunate to have those departments in this area. They're relatively good-sized departments. They're well-equipped departments. But you take the same thing and you go down to North Carolina in a very small department who's governed by a different government, state government, and they have different statutes down there, who very well their continuum, their use of force continuum, may not necessarily be the same as Virginia. Then you have, on top of that, you have decisions from particular courts. Here we're governed by the Fourth Circuit. So you go out to a different part of the country where it's far more liberal, if you will, California in particular, and their courts have rulings on aspects of law enforcement that will govern how those officers in that particular part of the country are to react, act, or whatever the case may be. So very good question, valid question, but easier in an organization like United States Army or the FBI, because we are, you know, FBI only has one director. You have one commander in chief and one guy at chief of staff. But for local departments and state departments, it's not necessarily that easy. I think that's a great point. I think it's a great question.
Anybody else want to chime in?
And that's where the President's 21st Century Task Force report is very, very intricate, because those are the things that he lined up that he is disseminating. The DOJ, Department of Justice, is disseminating, so in order to put police departments on the same line, to give guidance as to what they should be doing. But each state has their own Department of Criminal Justice Services who dictate the training for that particular state.
Wait. Y'all got to follow the rules. Because y'all cutting the line and everything. Give him a piece of paper and, no. Well, okay, we're going to get you, but I got questions before you, because then it's not fair to those people that pass their questions up. See, the Army just stand up and just think they can bogart stuff because you retired Army, you know. And then we're going to start barking in here in a few minutes because, you know, we're repping on the stage. I want y'all to know we're holding it down. Make us kick y'all stuff over. All right. Oh, Lord, Lord, how is he? Man, you just didn't. Let's get back on point here. Here's a question. Bro White, we're going to get you. I'm cutting the line, you know. All right. In the city of Richmond, when saying that education is key to change the situation, how do we do that with the state of our schools in the city?
I'm not scared. Chicken. Okay. But when we talk about education, the school system is one thing, but then there are a lot of other opportunities to educate our youth. And I don't know if you've seen in the news, but our police chief, he created a program called LIFE, and that's to help educate young people who are getting in trouble in order to avoid us having to arrest them, because we were becoming the bad person and we were introducing these children into the system. But in the city of Richmond, I'm responsible for the community care unit, and that's for police collaborations and partnerships. And that's what we do. We get out and we create partnerships so that we can create learning opportunities like this that are sponsored and hosted by the Richmond Police Department. So we have to think outside of the box when our hands are tied when we talk about this the school system, because that's pretty much out of our control.
Okay. Anybody else? Y'all just let that one alone, didn't you? Just, okay. What do you do? This is a good one. What do you do? Yeah. What do you do to change the thinking when you know there are good cops, but your friends and family have been continuously hurt by bad ones, assaulted, harassed, etc.? So what do you do? You want to change your thinking, but it seems like most of your interactions of your family and friends have not been positive.
Come on to the police station. Come inside. Get to know us. I offer internships. Students, children in the community can come and spend the whole summer with me from 8 to 4:30 every day just working and hanging out in the police department so that they can get to know what being a police officer is like. And they can get to know each one of us personally. When you only know someone from a certain position or a certain standpoint, I can tell you, everybody sitting up here, if we're driving down the road and we see those blue lights in our mirror, we are scared just like you are. Nobody wants to see those blue lights. And so it's important, relationships and communication, and that's what we have to do. We have to stop thinking it's community and versus police. We're all one. We've all talked about being human beings here, so we just have to get to know officers and get to have some understanding and ask questions. Even if you got a ticket, at least you can have a conversation with the police officer as to, okay, how could I do something different? We can't take the stance that the police is bad because that person's doing their job. And I've had to arrest a lot of people, but I treat them just like Rollins said. You treat people like you want to be treated, and you want your family treated. And I'm sitting up here, I'm from both sides of the tape. My father murdered my mother when I was 17 years old. So I know what it's like to lose someone and to lose a loved one to violence. And really what we should be talking about is this violence that's going on. This is what's piercing our communities, which is causing these incidents. I love to do research, and I'll share with you some statistics before we leave. But we have to start to address what's going on in our communities. We have black-on-black crime every day. Pastor White just talked about two people are dead this morning, and we're in the city of Richmond, we're averaging at least three a week in the last 3 or 4 months, and we're not talking about that. We need to be in these communities, getting to some understanding as to what's going on and why is this violence escalating in places like Chicago. We shouldn't just want to have conversations when a police officer take a life. We need to be having conversations when anybody take a life. Yeah. And we need to be protesting every day about the accessibility of guns and stuff like that, which is allowing these things to take place. So we have to be real about what's going on and not point the finger, but to get together and to have some think groups as to how we can change things.
Wow, good. Anybody else?
Just one quick thing. Also, the other thing you should do is, like, your pastor will preach to you every Sunday and then just about every day, to continue to have faith. We lose loved ones in our family and along the way all the time, but you continuously have faith in God and in your life. It's just the same here. I mean, just continue to have the faith and belief in what we are all here to do. We're not here for that negative reason, no. We're here to help you, to protect you. So just continue to believe, even though some loved ones might have been hurt, but that does not mean that every officer is here for that reason. So just continue to have faith in what we do and why we're here.
Okay. And I applaud each and every one of you, Sergeant Adams. That was powerful, because we try to exclude that point that we have an issue with violence that really needs to be spoken to, as powerful as all the other movements that we make when we're responding to feeling that we've been mistreated. Well, let's stop mistreating each other. Let's be as powerful in a movement and in a voice in that direction also. Okay, now, there's a lot of questions about your training and what goes into your training. How often are trainings offered to police officers, and are there, have there been additional trainings in lieu of the recent shootings? I guess we kind of touched on something. Go ahead.
From a training standpoint, I'm going to say no as far as any additional trainings per se. I will say for the Richmond Police Department has tried to be on the front end of a number of trainings prior to incidences occurring from the standpoint of, again, with the use of force training. We started use of force training back around 2004. Continuous training that all officers have to do at least twice per year. The crisis intervention training started a number of years ago. And at this point in time, we've seen, as a question was asked, reference dealing with mental health. We were on the front end of that, so we've been doing that. Now, as far as, again, the number of shootings that we've seen around the country, yes, that's alarming for us. That has somewhat of an effect on us because one of the things that was said again about education, we don't want the citizens in our community to think that because something happened a couple of thousand miles away, it's going to happen here. Again, we're still working on building those community relationships, as Sergeant Adams has said, partnering with different groups in the community to try to address various problems, the smallest up to the largest. So training is an integral part of what we're doing in the city of Richmond. I know we do a lot of work with Henrico, joint task forces on the city line just to address specific problems. Again, we've trained together. Give you a little history as well. I was on the Richmond SWAT team for 15 and a half years. I left the SWAT team in 2014. We did a lot of training during that time with Henrico's SWAT team. They looked out for our back, we looked out for them. Again, the training and the partnership building is one of the things I think the Richmond metropolitan area, we've been proud of as law enforcement officers, that knock on wood, we haven't had a lot of the issues that you've seen around the country.
Okay. Can I briefly, following up on that training component, and as the special agent said, he's absolutely correct. That is a void, depending on the region and the area you live in, with regard to the mandated training requirements. Here in Virginia, all law enforcement agencies are governed by the minimum standards set forth by the Virginia Department of Criminal Justice Services. They set forth the classes you take, the number of hours you take. They set forth the number of rounds you're supposed to shoot during your firearms qualification. Then they set forth the standards that you have to for recertification every year, culture sensitivity training for every 2 years. But those are minimum standards. they're minimum standards, and really what we experience and what folks don't realize is that depending on your agency, whether you're a forward-thinking agency like the police department in Henrico and Richmond that require additional training, additional time on the range, additional for use of force scenarios, those are left to individual departments, and that is a void, and that's a legitimate concern that the community should have with regard to where you all live and reside, whether it's here, whether it's in Charlotte, whether it's in Charleston. The training component is minimum at best, but it relies heavily on the police chief, the local sheriff, or the department agency head to decide to whether to further that training or not. And I'll give you an example. I know federal cases, when they talk about firearms use, firearm shooting, I think it's out in the 10th Circuit that says and sets the standard of your shooting has to be in low light. It has to be a certain number of rounds. It has to be the scenario base that you would expect your officers to see. In my research as an attorney, the 4th Circuit hasn't implemented that. And that's where we live. The 4th Circuit has not implemented that standard by law. Luckily, I will say this for my counterparts here, we're very blessed to have two departments, I'm going to say three, who are very, very aggressive in the way we train our law enforcement officers in how we do our shooting. We'll be out in Caroline County on the outdoor range where we will purposely put and call our folks there at low light conditions at night in order to be able to make that happen if our range doesn't occur. So for that, that is part of the education component that we have to get out to the community to understand that the one size model that fits all, what happens in the 10th Circuit may not always be what occurs here in the 4th.
Okay. Just so nobody thinks that their question is being overlooked, a lot of the questions are similar, so I'm going to try to group them together for time's sake and in hopes that we can get all of them responded to. These questions are dealing with community relations, some of it spurned by some of the statements made by Sergeant Adams, but question says, how do you plan on making your relationship with the community better, I guess, and just to add, this one is, how can the officers build relationship in the communities they patrol?
Well, in the city of Richmond, I think we're doing an awesome job. The officers go out, let's say it's Christmas Day, and the officers get called to a house, and they take care of whatever the issue was, but they notice there's no Christmas tree, and there's no Christmas there. And they pick up the phone, and they call back to the precinct and say, Sergeant Adams, do we have any toys that we can bring over here to this house for these babies? We do it every year, every day. We buy school clothes, we do Shop with a Cop, we do camps, and these are free things. We sponsor at least 200 kids a year for Christmas that we spend money out of our own pockets. We go to school. Dr. Seuss's birthday is coming up soon. Red Ribbon Week is coming up soon. All of these things. So, and a lot of our officers grew up here and are from here, so we are those babies, and we go back and we give back. And we create partnerships, and we continue to follow the children all the way up from elementary through high school. We have a program called the Young Adult Police Commissioners, where all inner city high school students can participate in this program. And we just had our induction ceremony on last Thursday, where we have 27 youth that will come to the police department twice a month. And we help them with SATs, PSATs, with whatever their plans, the next steps once they leave school. But we also talk to them when there are teen issues going on in the city so that we can have a better understanding, because we're the older people and we want to understand what's going on with the youth and to allow them, when these shootings occur, we ask them, how do they feel about it? What do they feel about what they've seen? And then by being around us, they have a different perception. So really, they get to go home and educate their families and their parents about what's right and what the police do and what we don't do. And even when we have protests, the students are allowed to come along so that they can see firsthand what our chief of police and our command staff is doing. So this is the way we're bridging the gap here in the city of Richmond. And every officer is responsible for community care or for caring for the community and going out. And we even have our Department of Social Services. This is a funny. The chief was at the city agency meeting with all the agency heads, and somebody told him that social service said that they referred someone from social services to the Richmond Police Department to me to help them. And he was like, wait, we're not social services, so why are they sending them to you? I said, well, sometimes there are policy guidelines that the service provider may have to stop. But if there's additional resources, that's what that person's doing, is trying to reach out to some additional resources so that we can help people. Crime occurs because people don't have. And if we educate people and connect them to the resources that we can help them have a healthy household, then things will get better. And that's what our responsibility is to bring in those resources, not just to go and to enforce the law.
Let me follow up on behalf of Sheriff Woody. I know he has several different programs already established that brings his deputies, who are correctional in nature, out into the community through our Meals on Wheels program, through our back-to-school event programs that we have that we've done successfully this past few summers, as well as Shop with a Cop that we do. And most of those things, and Pumpkin Patrol during Halloween, but I don't want folks to think that the idea was to bring material items to the community. What we realized was those were opportunities. Those were opportunities to interact with individuals in that neighborhood as we come through. Do we come through with a caravan full of 8 or 9 vehicles that are rolling 4 deep? Sure, because that's the level of commitment and involvement that I know Sheriff Woody has with deputies that want to be out in the community. When we get people that want to volunteer to drive all the way God's green earth to deliver these meals, because it's a chance for us to interact with some of the kids that are in the homes that don't have the food they need to have, so they can begin to see the individuals behind the shield as human. And that's a very critical component that we're allowed, that we could take advantage of to do. But I just wanted to plug that too for what the sheriff's office does. But we also bring the community into the jail. When we have our Mother's Day programs or our Father's Day program, understanding that when individuals from the frontline officers arrest these individuals, they come to the correctional facility, the families are hurting. It's the children at home that are missing a parent. And we open the doors, well, Sheriff Woody opens the doors, he has the keys, I don't, and provides the opportunity for children to at least on Father's Day and Mother's Day to experience and go through at least one of those special days with their loved one while they are paying their penance, being held accountable for their conduct, but recognizing that the parental bond is extremely important. So those are small, unique instances that we engage in to allow the people in the community to see that our folks who work in and day out, they go a 12-hour shift inside of a correctional facility, and this was before we had the new city jail. That's very nice. They did the time, too. They went in there and they gutted it out, and after their 12-hour shift, they were seen as human beings because they treated folks with dignity and care.
Will, yeah, you're saying something like what?
I won't take too much time, but we've got a lot of similar programs that Richmond does have. As far as our community involvement, if you guys have a program, you guys want us to come out, you can call us. We'll come out, we'll be part of that. We want to be part of the community. We work here, we live here, we play here, we're here for you, we're here with you. Don't hesitate to call us, okay?
Special Agent DeLoach, anything from your
couple? Very similar. We enjoy our relationships we have with our local partners. If there's anything that you all need from us, from Special Agent in Charge Adam Lee, who was going to come out to this event, but was double booked, and I had the great opportunity to come out. If you need anything from the Richmond FBI office, don't hesitate whatsoever. I can be your point of contact. I can certainly give you that information at some point doing this conversation. But we are in the community as well, standing right beside our partners. No question about it.
All right. These questions, again, I'm trying to group similar questions together, are about I guess community relations and what the community can do. So it says, how is we as citizens how can we help more? And to add on, how do we create an atmosphere where Black people respect the police and don't feel as though they have to be scared of the police? So what can we do as citizens to help facilitate an environment that is one of helps towards our law enforcement and create, I guess, you know, try to minimize or desensitize this thought that there is a fear of African Americans towards law enforcement officers. Now, I'm gonna tell you, I like all y'all. I ain't scared of you.
One word or one phrase, if you will, talk to us. That's all you gotta do. You know, like I said, I use Wawa as an example because that's where I usually get my coffee in the mornings. Come up and talk to me. There's no need to be scared of me. I don't wish anybody any harm. Nobody up here wishes anybody any harm. There's not a police officer out there that wishes anybody any harm. We took this job. It's funny. We put your application in and you go through all your interviews and everything. I'll be quick. But exactly. When you come in, they ask you, why do you want this job? I can pretty much guarantee everybody up here said, I want to help people. That's what we're here for. We're here to help you.
Okay, so how? I mean, how is we as citizens, how can we bridge this? Because it seems like there is a great divide. And maybe it's really all in our minds. That's our perception, that there is a great divide about, you know, how we can really help, what we can do. How do we change the depiction or the deception that African Americans and the police can't get along?
Okay, one thing first is the adults, the older people, because we're teaching the children the wrong way. When we're in uniform, and how many parents you see, they have their baby and they say, you better be good, unless I'm gonna make them take you away. I'm gonna make them lock you up.
All the time.
You are piercing, you are terrifying that child, and you're telling that child that we're the bad people. And I use Santa Claus as the example, okay? When child don't want to go sit on Santa's lap, you make him go and sit up there on that,
yeah, okay.
I'm going to call him a dirty old man's lap because he's holding children, right? But you push him or her to Santa and make them sit on Santa's lap. But you get to us, and we're gonna die trying to save a child, whether it's jumping to a lake with freezing cold water. We will do anything to save a child's life. But you parents will tell that child that that's the bad guy, that's the bad person. Don't, that person's gonna lock you up and take you away. When that is one of many things that we do. And even if you've had a bad experience with the police, have a conversation to get some understanding. We have internal affairs. If an officer mistreats you, curses at you, call and report that officer, because we do not want that person to be a part of our family, because that person is making it hard for the rest of us, and that's not acceptable. We're responsible for policing each other. If I witness them doing something wrong, first of all, I'm gonna put them in check, and I'm gonna tell on them. And my police chief, if I don't tell on Ray, I'm in more trouble than Ray is. And that's how we roll. It's not a thin blue line that we are protecting each other. That's not acceptable. But as the community, you all, we have to educate our young people about what authority means, what police mean, but that we have these horror stories, and the children are listening to everything you say. And so we have to stop having those conversations where we're teaching. It's just like racism, really. It's just like racism. We're teaching hatred to the people who are supposed to protect and serve. So that's what the community can do. We can start having better and more positive conversations. If you go to the store and you get a bad experience with the clerk, you're not gonna stop going to that store, right? You're gonna still go. But you have to, and the same thing with us. So don't judge us according to one incident, because that is not the way it should be.
Anybody else?
No, that was well said.
What she said. Okay, right along the same line says this. It says, I'm a white female nurse. I work at MCB in the trauma unit. I've cared for many young gun victims, and I would like to ask if it's okay for me to tell a wounded male or female about changing their life directions. And how do I respond to this senseless loss for life and destruction? Yeah.
Y'all were invited here to talk. Yes.
I know, right?
Be a human being. I mean, because it is senseless. And like I said, I wanted to share some stats with you all. And this is a fact. I urge you all to go online and to look up and to read everything. It says, it would take cops 40 years to kill as many black men that have died at the hands of other black men in 2012 alone. Wow. Do you understand that? Alone. That's senseless killings. And it is important that when I'm in my uniform, I'm a mama, I'm a grandmama, I'm a human being, and I'm trying to encourage and to help redirect people's lives. And if I can say a word that may help them change that road that they're on, that's what I'm supposed to do. And sometimes, you know, we all have boundaries, but you know what? We're human beings. We have this line of our profession, but you have to be a human being. So when you encounter somebody and something's not quite right, and you never know, you might be that person that has helped redirect them. And that's just like guys and gals that are standing out on the street. In my police car, I know what they're doing, but I roll up every day. Did you go looking for a job today? You know, because you can't get your hustle on right here. I let them know I know what they're doing, but I try to encourage them. Lowe's is hiring. Come on and go down the street. I already talked to the people about a job for you. So that's what we're supposed to do as human beings, not just stand on the sidelines and let the people go astray. We're here in the church. We're all supposed to be reaching out and bringing people into the fold and spreading the light and the love of God and Jesus Christ. And when we walk past and we ignore them, we are letting God down. Wow. And we have to do better at that. People are lost. We all have lost family members. So when we're looking at the people out in the street, it is our family, just different shade, different shape, different city. It's our family. And we may not be able to connect with our family members, but somebody else may be able to. So it is our responsibility, and that's why God put us here on this earth, to make some changes and to do his work and to spread his love and to spread his light.
So don't say y'all ain't had no teaching today. Yeah, we'll say yeah what she said. Okay. Well, I think it was a question to ask, how do you feel about the unnecessary murders around the country? But I think Sergeant Adams has expressed passionately pretty much the opinion of the panel on how they feel about the unnecessary murders that are taking place. And this was not police, this was just in general, the unnecessary violence that was taking place. So unless somebody else has an additional point they'd like to make on that, I think her statistics a great story.
All right, it says Chicago's death toll is almost equal to that of both wars, Iraq and Afghanistan combined.
Wow. And the funny thing is that's not the police, that's
black on black crime. Yeah. This and we're not protesting. People should be out there protesting. People should be out there in the street trying to get some understanding as to what's going on and why are we having all of this violence. Instead, we're sitting on the sidelines and we're just allowing it to happen.
And I think we have to be honest. Education, economics, and opportunity are playing a major role in the stuff that we're seeing. This is not the world that I grew up in. You know, I'm 53 years old. This is just not it. Neighborhoods are not even neighborhoods. Communities are not even communities because we do not commune. I grew up in a time when Miss Shirley just walked in your house, knocked on the door and said, coming in. Miss Shirley beat my butt, sent me home, called my mama, and by the time I got home, there was another beating waiting because Miss Shirley had to, it wasn't even because what you did, it's because Miss Shirley had to beat your butt and you embarrassed the name of your, oh yeah, but you was, yeah, it was gonna be a long day. Now that was hazy. So, you know, but we've lost that sense of connection. You know, I just thought about it. You know, I have two neighbors. One I know well because he's my fraternity brother. But the other neighbor, you know, we good, but for as close as he lives to me, we don't fellowship like we could. Our community that I live in has 75 houses and I know two people named. Yeah, shame on me, right? But I'm just saying that thing of playing in the street and everybody knowing everybody and going and borrow some sugar. Michelle and my mama say she need a cup of sugar. You know, that doesn't happen anymore. We've lost the sense of living in real communities and neighborhood, which makes it easier for me to harm you. It was hard. We fought, but we wouldn't, you know, ain't nobody gonna mess nobody up. One, you had to go home. And two, you know, we cared about one another, and a sense of that is really has been diminished. So, yeah, it does. One thing, somebody said, what can we as a community do? We can start having the same compassion that Christ had for us. Yeah, that's my preaching this morning. So, okay, back to you guys. Is there ever a sense of intimidation when you're responding to a call?
Jerry?
Stand up, Will.
I read it as is, but I'm going to think from what you are walking up
from
on,
the incident, from the scene.
Yeah, from what you're
from
walking up, what you're approaching.
I'm kind of intimidated right now.
No. Okay, is there ever a sense of intimidation when you're responding to a call? So I'm going to think what you're approaching, what you're walking up on, is it intimidating to you?
There's uncertainty. Uncertainty, yes. And it depends on what the call is. In Richmond, we could receive a call of somebody walking down the street with an AK-57, AK-7. 57. I'm thinking about the bullet. But you think about that. If I'm receiving that call, and stay standing, Will. If okay. I'm receiving that call, can you imagine if you were a police officer and you got to go on a call and somebody's walking down the street with an AK-7? 47, 57, whatever. Right. Imagine a big rifle, a big gun. Think about that. And know what? Will can't say, I don't want to go, Carol, you go. Right? And I can't say, Will, I don't want to go, you go. When we get the call, we have to go. It does not, we can't say, we'll sit this one out. We don't want to go. We're not going to do this one. And the person is walking down the street with an AK-47? That's something. It happens quite a bit. Quite a bit. And so we have to get our mindset together. When you hear AK-47 already out in the street, walking down the street, we got to do some serious thinking and getting ourselves a plan together, because we got to get there and we got to address that. So when you think about that, that's what we have to analyze. But I asked him to stand up. I'm 5'5 and weigh 99 pounds. And Will, stand up, sweetheart. Now, if I roll up on them and they out on the corner and they got their hands in their pocket and it's wintertime and they got on these big balloon coats and I can't see what's in their pockets or what's in their hands, I have to do some serious talking to get them hands out their pockets so that I can feel safe. And that's what we encounter a lot. And if they don't respond to what I ask them to do, I have to continue that. I can't just walk away and say, okay, y'all good, because I'm the police. And because Aunt Shirley is over there looking out the window, and she done called me because she know them boys out there on the corner, they got drugs and they got guns, because she done told us, because she done seen them. And if I get in the car and walk away and say, okay, y'all all right, Miss Shirley gonna call back and say, you know that little police lady came, but she ain't do nothing. She didn't do anything. So I have to be able to communicate with them enough to get them to follow my instructions. But in all reality, when I roll up in my police car, they need to be putting their hands out so I can see them and moving on down the street, because they know I'm coming to have an encounter with them, all right? But when I get there and I start to speak to them, that's the next level. That when the police car get there, whatever's going on, supposed to cease. But when we get out the car, that's the next thing. When we start to talk to them, that's next. All of these things happen before we even just, that's what we want you all to understand. When you see the police car, that's a level of respect right there. It's like, hold on, whatever we're doing, we got to get it together. That's just like it's 4:05, mama getting home at 4:00. We got to hustle and get this house clean, because we know she's going to be on us because we haven't done what we were supposed to do. And then when I start to ask them to do things, if they don't comply because I asked them to, then what next? And if it's wintertime, they got these big coats on and I can't see, and they both got guns on, you can see one, but you can't see the other one that's here. But I know it's here. I know it's there, right? All right? Right? But while I'm having an encounter with them, I got those three over there. They checking me out. And mind you, it's just me right now. So what can I do against the six of them? And you know they know each other because they're in close proximity of each other and they're in the same community. So that is that, yes. So when we get to places, sometimes it is just us. And then when backup get there, but if they decide they want to run and all of that stuff, what could I do to stop them? By myself, what could I do? I can run fast. I'm going to catch one, but I can't catch all five of them. So that's what we want you all to understand. Every call we go on, there's uncertainty. When we walk up in a house, it's uncertainty. Everybody in that house knows what's there except for us. And if I'm in the house, Will can't go walking over there where past that, because I don't know what they got over there. You got to stay right here. You got to stay right here and not move. And so that's what happens sometimes when you hear people say, well, the police were mean. They made us sit down. They made us stand for hours. We have to contain what we have, because when people start to move around, they're in their environment, not in our environment. Same thing with the car. If they were in the car and they were reaching and tucking and all of that stuff, I don't know what's in that car. They could so easily have a gun and pull it out. Every time we have an encounter with a citizen, that is an unknown for us. There is no guarantee that we will walk away from that incident. It just all depends on the mindset of the person that we're having that encounter with. So there's always uncertainty.
And if there's one thing that you can take away, and I have four sons, ranging in age from 33 to 25. If there's one thing that I can tell them, one thing I will tell you, and you spread the word, is when you encounter a police officer, whether it be a traffic stop or the officer comes out to your home, is comply. I mean, that is the key thing. You're not going to win an argument or a fight. It's not going to turn out right if you do it in the street. If you have a question, a problem with that particular situation, that officer searched my car and didn't have any right to search my car. Or that officer did something or said something that he should not or she should not have said. There's a process. And that process is letting that officer supervisor know. Or when you go to court to challenge those charges. If it's unconstitutional, if it's a Fourth Amendment violation, then there's a place and time to have that discussion, folks. It is not in the street. And just because an officer says something to you and you don't like what they say, as Carol said, we're coming to the unknown. We don't know what you have or what you're capable of or what you may do. So if I could tell folks anything and take away from this and spread it out, because this is exactly what the conversation I've had with my sons for a number of years, is to comply. If there are issues and you're in an area where you don't trust the department, there's other places to go. But don't think that your hands are tied because you're in a situation where an officer is telling you, remove your hands from your pocket. Well, you don't want to. Comply, comply, comply. One of the other myths that's out there is, well, if I get pulled over by the police, what do I have to do? You got to do two things. Two things for sure. And that's produce a driver's license. And if they ask you to get out of the car, get out of the car. Those two things you got to do. And it doesn't matter if I'm sitting here in Virginia or my other offices that I've worked in, working civil rights in Kansas City or New York, it's the same. If the police ask you to get out of the car, get out of the car. Comply. Anything else that happens in terms of you didn't think you were treated fairly or you believe there's some issues with a search on reasonableness or the force, there's other ways to handle that. There are absolutely other ways to handle that, and don't do it in the street.
Thank you, Ray Head. To piggyback on what he said, compliance, using a traffic stop as an example, compliance. If you feel you weren't treated appropriately, ask for a supervisor to respond to that location. That officer should get on his or her radio, and a supervisor should respond. And you can have that conversation with the supervisor. If that doesn't pan out, you can also contact the Internal Affairs Department. And I'm sure in the city of Richmond, and same for Henrico, if you have a concern or you have a complaint, contact the Internal Affairs Department. They will take that information. 9 times out of 10, an investigation will be initiated either through Internal Affairs based on what the allegation is, or it's going to go back to the precinct supervision to conduct an investigation. You have a process to vent, not on scene if you're having an encounter with an officer. Again, that is the last place, because that's when the officer is going to call other officers. Other officers are going to come and create a bad situation. Well, a bad situation can be the result, because someone is not complying. It's something as simple as providing the driver's license.
I think Ray had something simple. He said, get home safe.
Bottom line, and again,
at the end of the day,
I have a son, 22 years old. We've had that talk many, many, many times. Do what's asked. That is not the place to try to fight about.
Dee Dee, Tony was telling me about an example you give what was it, with the robber or whatever, if you, how you would comply. Wasn't that right, Tom? I think that's what it's talking about. You use the example about if you were being held up by at gunpoint.
You know, I say this as an anecdote because Johnny McRoy from the police department posted this on Facebook that I saw.
Oh, it really said it was Brother Didi.
No, I wouldn't put words in your mouth,
bro.
No, Johnny's an alpha, so I'm not afraid to put words in Johnny's mouth. But let me say this. One of the things I came here to do was to listen and to dialogue. And part of dialoguing is listening to some concerns. But when I saw the posting, it was kind of unique because the posting from a police officer said this. He marveled at how odd it was that nowadays, if you yourself were on the street and a robber walked up to you and put a gun in your face and demanded your wallet, many people, 99% of the times, and you know, Pastor White, you agreed, what do? You comply. You give him the wallet because you want to go home. You want to go home that day alive.
Get you all my stuff real cool. That
was a nice watch. And so the next, though, but he said was, but the sentiment nowadays seems to be different, that if a police officer, if, and I say that if, because most of the times, even on traffic stops, and I've driven by them and seen them, when they do the stop, they are not automatically out of holster. They are not automatically out of holster. If there's a circumstance that you see an officer out of holster, and there's voice commands given for the individual to comply, at that point in time, it just seems that people aren't complying. And that goes towards the further discussion of compliance. But the fact that he used the example of a street robbery and how ordinary citizens in everyday encounters, or with a bladed instrument, it doesn't have to be a gun, it could be a knife, against a woman, right? Some people are so stricken with fear, they comply. But nowadays, from his posting, it just seems that that's not the case, even when an officer has a weapon drawn, doing their job to enforce the law, that people don't. But now that you put me on the spot, I just had to put that comment out.
But no, that's good, because it's funny, we do. You know, if we are in that situation, we're so quick to comply without question. But if we get pulled over, now I got a lot of questions before I comply. And I'm going to tell you the truth, I just want to get home safe. You know, I look too good to be, Brother Didi, you know, you do this at a different level. What about you, intimidations and some of the interactions you had? And I just wanted to see if you had some other thoughts.
Well, my thought is not too different from what the sergeant was saying earlier. I was on the street just like everyone, last one of us up here for a long time. And certain times, like Sergeant was saying, you know, you patrolling the area. When I wasn't patrolling, patrol areas that I would say I have to be in because of the violence that goes on for the job I was doing at the time. My job at that time, like, was considered a small unit task force called Focus Mission Team, and we would go in the areas where there was a high violence, whether it was drugs or a lot of other illegal activity that goes on at the time. Most of the time, you know, we're partnered up in the car, but sometimes, you know, well, 99% of the time you're partnered up, but sometimes you might be, like, so it depends on what the situation. Anyway, I can give you this one example. Years ago when we were assigned beats, when I first started here, you were assigned a beat. And on a beat, you are in charge of a certain area, so like this whole little block of seats right here. And within that, I have to engage this area all the time, daily, on my beat. In a certain location where a lot of people were standing, like Sergeant saying, on the corner, my job is, I have to get out there and address that situation. And I was by myself in the car because you were a single person in the car for those beats or for the job. So yes, I would go up, and you might have five or six people standing there on the corner. Every last one of them, maybe one out of the six, are narcotics dealers. And that's very true. On that area where I was at. I would get out, and I approach these gentlemen. Of course, I got somebody else coming to me because they know I let it known before I can get out of the car, that, you know, for a $5 I'm talking to But my job is I have to communicate with these individuals and find out why they're there and to instruct them. If they're not there for whatever good reason, they need to be moved. So yes, I know intimidation is there, but coming from my background, where I was raised, coming from, you know, knowing how to approach individuals in a calm manner, try to keep things calm and talk to them directly without making them feel like, you know, I'm coming up hard on them. You know, they understood what I was going on. But they also understood I wasn't playing the game either. So yes, it's a little intimidation. It could be a little intimidating. You could be a little intimidated at that time, but you know, it depends on how you carry yourself, how you handle the situation until somebody gets there and you carry on that way.
All right, we're gonna wrap this up. Brother White, you still have a question? You good? Oh, you do? Okay, come on.
I just want to say something. I hear that all the time. I do. And I know a lot of us hear that all the time. The stuff you see on TV, it's not real. You know, shoot somebody in the hand or something like that.
Come up here, Pastor. Come up here.
Yeah.
Are you
missing? Well, come on the stage. You just started trouble.
I'll give you the legal perspective on why.
If y'all playing with guns, I just want to move to the back of the stage, because I told you my goal every day is to get home safe, even from church. Oh.
We're taught to shoot center mass. We have to stop the threat, okay? If that person is shooting and posing a threat.
If a person has a knife, I'm going to see where you. All right, you have the gun, I got a knife. Right? Your gun is not out yet. Your gun is holstered. Okay? You're talking to me. I want you to make a move on me as if I got a knife. I got a knife out. And you're trying to talk to me to have me drop the knife.
Don't drop my mic, though.
Okay, sir, drop the knife.
After you're talking to me, this is a good little scenario, real quick. I'm going to show now. So I know there's a lot more to it, but anyway. You talking to me, and I'm not complying to what you're saying. I got a knife. The next thing you can do, you go on holster, correct?
Yeah.
So you go on holster. You talking to me, all right? You talking to me.
Pow, pow!
See?
I'm already. He said pow, pow.
You don't know that. You don't know that's going to happen, though. You have no idea. I'm on you. You shooting down here, you're going to miss me. You don't know when I'm going to make a step.
Somebody got, okay. Got a question about faith. I was kind of saying faith to close it out.
Now you 10 feet away, you make one step. My next shot, I'm going to shoot you. Now. You know, if the guy continue to approach you, then why can't you just shoot him in his leg? Something like that to keep him from advancing forward.
Keep on.
Why do I have to get some mask?
Go ahead, keep talking. You got the gun. Keep talking to him.
Oh, I'm asking the question.
All right, Ray. Go ahead, Ray.
I know exactly.
Here we go. Best way to address this example that was given right here. It's for everyone in here to come schedule a time to come to Richmond Police Training Academy to participate with the Milo program. This scenario is in it. And it will see if your theory is correct or his theory is correct.
I know.
How many of you all would be willing to come to the academy to do that? Now, what I will do tomorrow is contact personnel at the Richmond Police Training Academy. You will be my contact.
Cool.
Just to schedule a time for you all to come and have that true experience. We can stand here and talk and chit-chat and do what we talked about earlier as that Monday morning quarterbacking. Right. No stress is on you right now. I guarantee when you start that program, you can get a little nervous. You can have that.
Uh-oh. Heart jumping, your heart jumping, hands, everything.
Because of the program, give you a hint. You dictate what the program does. If you do one thing, the program is going to do the other. If you do, in some instances, what we want the officers to do, everybody goes home. If you don't do what we want the officers to do, a good chance you may not go home. So that gives you a little bit more reality so that you'll be in the moment to have that experience of what an officer feels like when he or she responds to a call for service and we're going into the unknown where you ask, is it intimidating?
Exactly. All right, and so if I may, this is a question that is asked, and thank you for asking that question, by the way, because this question is on everybody's mind, to be quite honest with you. The reality of it is police officers are trained, as Carol said, to shoot center mass, central nervous system area. So center mass. Limbs are not center mass. It is actually specialized training, which most police officers, a large majority, over 90% of them, are not trained to shoot a firearm out of someone's hand, for example. That is Hollywood. And Hollywood has unfortunately added that myth into folks' mind that, hey, I can shoot him in the leg and it'll stop him. The reality, again, is in that scenario that you just played out on stage, even if you shoot a person, and Hollywood would have you believe that as soon as you discharge your firearm as a police officer, the person is lifted off the ground with one bullet, and goes flying through some plain glass window. That is not reality. Reality is, once you fire your firearm, and I don't care if it's two or three or four shots, that person, unless you hit a critical part in their body, they're going to continue moving towards you with momentum. And I'll tell you, it's just like anything else. If they've got the determination to kill you or cause you harm, they, in most cases, may very well get to you. It is, we're all trained, and we've all gotten rid of the "we shoot to kill." That's we don't even say that. We shoot to eliminate the threat. And if there is still a threat, is the reason why you have shootings from police officers where the range of bullets are 10 to 15 or more, because the threat was not eliminated. Don't for one second believe that it's one shot, one kill. That's in video games and that's in Hollywood. But we're on the side of the road, or we're in the apartment complex where we've got, you know, 15 people standing by watching what's happening. It may be many shots because you're trained to eliminate the threat. You're not shooting to kill them. But we also are never trained, unless, and Ray said it, he was on a SWAT, I was a sniper. Unless you're in those specialized areas, the vast majority, the rest of us who are police officers or sheriff's deputies or troopers, they're trained to shoot one place. Police officers aren't even trained headshots, quite frankly. If they happen, it's happened because it's part of that specialized training oftentimes. So I want you to spread that word as well and let folks know that it's Hollywood. It's really, in the military, we train the same way. It's center mass. It's because it's the largest part of the body. You have a greater opportunity to shoot it. But that's in a sterile environment. Think about when my heart rate is racing and I'm shaking and I've got adrenaline running through me and I know someone is trying to harm me And either there's movement one way or the other. Either he or she is moving, or I'm moving. Now, that center of mass area, yeah, I might hit him in the leg, but I won't aim him for the leg. I might hit him in the head, but I won't aim it for the head. So center mass is where officers are trained to shoot. And again, that Hollywood notion that one bullet is going to put someone down does not work. It doesn't happen. And I'm sure we can all attest to that, is that even in that situation with the knife, the guy with the knife would have still stabbed you multiple times, because he would have gotten to you. Even if you would have shot him in the leg, his adrenaline would have carried him through that incident. He would have felt the pain later, but he wouldn't have felt it before he got to you. So thank you for that question.
Wow. Okay. Our time is almost up here, and I appreciate you guys being here. Want to give you one last question, and then we want to talk about the role of our faith. And the last question is this: do you feel that we're headed back to a time of martial law?
No.
No.
Okay. Look, I'm taking advantage of being passive. Here's a, you know, we watched the debate, and one of the candidates, stop and frisk, you know. Any thoughts, you know, that it's crazy to me to even think that something like that would be instituted, you know, from your perspective?
It was an absolute, the purpose of stop and frisk, the mindset behind it, the intent, was a noble. It was legitimate. The problem that came from it, right, is the fact that it targeted a particular group of individuals. And I think if you watch the debate, I think you got that from either the commentator or the opposing presidential candidate, is that it was ruled unconstitutional. And I think the premise of it, though, for a law enforcement perspective, was legitimate when it was installed in that particular in New York in particular, but I don't see us going back to that. I don't think it's going to go in any other direction. I think most folks understand that now, so I think we're good.
The policy is offensive. Coming from a prosecutor, it's offensive. Under Terry v. Ohio back in 1964, the premise was individualized stopping of an individual and then frisking only when you had articulable suspicion that the individual was armed. So there was the initial stop where you had to, as a peace officer, to make a determination that the individual felt, or you as an officer felt, the individual was committing a crime, and then came the frisk. But those were individualized circumstances. And what New York did was they implemented a blanket rule that law officers could stop indiscriminately anyone they wanted and frisk them. And to me, believing in the Constitution, that was absolutely unjustified in my mind, regardless of the level of crime that was occurring, because we have to protect and safeguard the law-abiding citizens' constitutional rights against governmental intrusion into their own persons. Now, police officers, and the data showed when the court ruled that the blanket policy, remember, the blanket policy was what was ruled unconstitutional, not the individualized officer's ability. If Didi was on the street and saw somebody do a throwdown of an item that he suspected from his training was an off-white rock-like substance that he believed to be crack cocaine or cocaine base, he is at that time able to get out of the vehicle and engage in a stop with that individual. And if he can articulate a particularized belief that the individual was armed and dangerous, he could do the frisk. So I want folks to understand that through the conversation and the debates, we lost sense and the direction of what the law is in our country. And the concept of an individualized stop and frisk still exists, but a blanket ability for a law enforcement officer to do that is not. And that's your...
Okay. All right. I want to close out with this.
want to give you this opportunity as we prepare to close out. Again, we so appreciate you guys giving up your time to be here with us. I so wish the many that asked for this were showed up to participate in this, but again, grateful for those that are here. As people of faith, and I make a blanket assumption that we all are, what role do you see your faith playing in resolution, not only to this issue, but just to the issues from the platform you have of touching our community? What role do you see faith, what's the God role in all of this? And as we, as people of faith, you know, what's a charge that you would leave us? And then any other closing remarks that you might want to leave with the group? And I'm just, you know, not rushing you, but just asking you to be mindful, you know. So, well, we start at even end and just take it on down.
Okay, I'm going to be very brief. Today is my wife's birthday. So as people of faith, could y'all pray for me when I go home? I've been here for several hours, and she knows it. So she's going to get a nice little gift when I leave here. But I will say this, that we're all God's creatures. And I think Scripture talks about not letting, and I'll paraphrase because I'm not really good at remembering Scripture as opposed to remembering statutes, but allowing false words come out of our own mouths against other people. And when we leave this room of fellowship and spiritual uplift with each other through God's grace, we need to, I believe that I remember that before I speak ill, before I pass judgment on a particularized situation, having experienced what I experienced here with my colleagues up here, to be patient, to listen, and to hear and wait for the facts, and to provide a proper perspective to my neighbor. Sadly, you don't know your neighbors, but to get to know your neighbors and to provide that appropriate perspective, to teach our children, to teach our neighbors' children, to teach our family's children the very same thing. So that's how my faith would play into how I would walk out of this situation and being a voice in the community.
Well, today is my birthday, actually.
Well, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
And what I'll say is, and I'll be brief as well, I think the church plays a huge part. I think we have to be good stewards of each other. I think it's incumbent upon us to pass on the information and the knowledge that you have. Be leaders in your community. If someone else is not standing up, you know, take that place. We certainly are, you know, representatives of our community, and we want to make sure our community is very strong. I think we all have a responsibility in doing that. And for the nurse who was in the audience to ask the question, we all have that duty, that responsibility to take care of our neighbor. So with that, I have really appreciate you guys having us out here today. Thank you.
Okay, yeah. Nah, not too much to, pretty much they both said the same as what I would have liked to say. Not everything is happening, but still, as far as the faith, and just continue to believe in who we are and what we do. Continue to reach out to those out there around you and continue to make sure they believe in everything we do. Continue to pray for us and them to make sure they go out and do the right things and, you know, the days be better days. But other than that, I too thank you for inviting me out.
Love thy neighbor, right? Again, we're all flesh and blood. Let's talk. That's what I'm all about. Thank you, guys.
As a law enforcement officer, one thing that we, is our focus and mission is preservation of life. How can we continue working on the preservation of life, law enforcement officer, citizens, continue to treat everyone we encounter the way we want to be treated. Sounds like it's something that's simple to do, but we all have to work on doing that. Work on doing that. Treat each other the way you would want to be treated. Thank you for having me.
God is the Father of us all, and we're all His children, no matter what shape, what size, or what color. And we all have a duty to Him. He gave us this life with a purpose, and we have to be about the purpose that He has given to each and every one of us, to reach out and to bring others into the fold. When I talk about my life, it's just been a piggyback ride with God, because like I said, my father murdered my mother when I was 17, so I could be doing anything except for what I do now. And I'm not ashamed or afraid of my history, my background, or where I come from. And I share that. And when God sent Jesus back here, He walked the streets. He didn't have cover. He was not inside. He had His disciples outside. They didn't understand, but that's the way that we have to be. We have to reach outside of the walls with which we work, or that we seek comfort. We have to get out there and be with the people who are lost. We have to have some understanding about them and where they are, and to help bring them back into the fold. It doesn't matter whether we understand them or we understand the what, the whys. That's not our job. Our job is to extend a helping hand and to help them. And, you know, sometimes we come out of bad situations and we move up like the Jeffersons, and we forget where we came from. We forget everybody back there. We watch on TV, but we don't do anything to help. So for me, just reach out and do those things and give abundantly. I love the song that we sing, to give it all away, to give it all away, because when you leave, you can't take anything. And so for you to have and somebody else not to have, we have a lot of babies out there who are suffering. We have a lot of babies who don't have people who can help them with their homework, who don't live in a loving, kind, and caring environment. Volunteer, go to school, reach out, go to the Boys and Girls Club. Everything that your children have, there's a child who has not even a portion of that. And we have to teach our babies who have so much in abundance to be able to give back, and that there are other children who don't have. You know, we see commercials with children in other countries, but we have children right here in the United States, right here in the city of Richmond, that we need to be able to help. And moms, I want to plead with you to take back your rightful place. God made women special. We're the catalyst for life into this world, and we have dropped the ball. We're not reaching out to the other moms, the other sisters, and teaching them the right way. So we have to do that. And the men too, our babies, our boys are missing a father figure. And where they don't have, we need to replace those things. And we need to reach out to people that we don't know, we've never met before, but to do these things, because that's what God's work is all about.
Amen. Won't you stand with me? I would be dismissed to ask them to come, and knowing the positions they hold in our community.